Good morning, Croxley Dean School, and welcome to the penultimate assembly of the year. As you can see, I've taken my assembly outdoors this week just to give a good link to that virtual sports day that you all competed in last week, and the results will be shared with you by Mr. Murphy at the end of the assembly. You will all be able to see how you've got on, what houses and in which year group competed the most, but our assembly focus this week is going to be on the challenges that us as staff have set ourselves. So you'll see staff introduce what they've done and how they've achieved it. So our assembly today is about achieving your goals. Now, as you can see, I just finished my run, the last one before the assembly. And as from the previous assembly, I mentioned to you about trying to get 2.6 kilometers in 12 minutes. Now, I've been working entirely hard each Saturday to run the 2.6. It has been extremely difficult. And as you can see, very hard work. So this week, I managed to get 13.08, which is an achievement from the previous weeks, but it's still not met my target. So I have to keep working hard, training in the week to get it down to those 12 minutes. I have got a year to do that, and hopefully by then, I can tell you that I have beat the target of 12 minutes and accomplished the test, which is a nationwide test for those Premiership referees. So the first person I would like to introduce is Miss Matthews.
Hello everyone. I've been really interested, while I've been at home, finding out what other people have been doing. And in the video that I'm about to show you, you're going to see two Paralympians explain the sorts of things they get up to while they've been at home during lockdown. In the video, Ellie Robinson mentioned that she'd been doing some baking while she's been at home. And baking is one of my passions. I really enjoy doing it when I get time. And now that I've got a little bit of time, I'm going to show you my recipe on how I make my fruit scones.
For this recipe, you will need 225 grams of self-raising flour, 1 teaspoon of baking powder, 50 grams of softened butter, 25 grams of caster sugar, 50 grams of mixed dried fruit, 1 egg, and a little bit of milk. The first thing you need to do before you start mixing the ingredients is to preheat the oven. So 220 degrees or 200 fan is perfect. So the first thing we need to do is to add the flour and the baking powder to the bowl. The next thing we need to add is the butter. Once you've added the butter, using your fingertips, you need to mix them together until the mixture resembles fine breadcrumbs. Once all the butter has been mixed in, you need to add the sugar and the dried fruit and stir all the ingredients together.
The next thing you need to do is break the egg into a measuring jug and then add enough milk so that it reaches about 150 mils of liquid. That's about right.
Next, you need to slowly add the milk and egg mixture into the bowl so that it forms a soft dough. Add it a little bit at a time so it doesn't get too wet. So this is how my dough looks now. Next, you need to put this dough onto the work surface, but before you do that, put a little bit of flour on the work surface so that it doesn't stick. And then you need to roll it out so it's about 1 centimeter thick. And then using a cutter, cut out your scones from the dough. Once you've cut out all of the scones from the dough that you can roll it back up into a ball and re-roll it, and then continue to make some more until you've used up all the dough. My scones are now ready to go into the oven, and I'm going to put them in there for about 10 minutes until they are kind of a light golden brown colour. Then take them out and enjoy. Here are my finished scones. I'm going to let them cool a little bit, and then I'm going to cut them in half, and my favourite way to eat them is with clotted cream and raspberry jam. Enjoy!
The second person I'd like to introduce is Miss Davis. Thank you to Miss Matthews.
Hi everyone, I hope you're all well, of course. We're almost there at the end of the year. Keep motivated, keep going. You're doing a great job. It's been fantastic to hear from all of you and how you've been getting on, especially from PE wise. So keep doing what you're doing, and you can enjoy your summer holidays in a couple of weeks' time. So many of you have been taking part in the pastoral challenges that have been set each week on the pastoral bulletin. So I thought, why not give it a go myself? So I took up one of the challenges of baking something this week, and safe to say that I'm no baker. I won't be going on MasterChef anytime soon, or the Great British Bake Off for that matter, because the best thing I could possibly do is make a poached egg, even if that is a fine art. So I thought I'd take up the challenge and do some flapjacks. So I've made some flapjacks, I did a little video for you to see how I made them. You can give it a go if you want to, it's up to you. But keep going, keep working up to the end of term, you've got this. Enjoy your summer holidays, and of course stay safe, and we all can't wait to see you come September.
So a big thanks to Miss Davies, and now on to Miss Broadus.
I've been practicing. I don't think I can do 30 seconds, but I can do better than I did before. So here we go. I found these little chucking chickens that were made on a Young Enterprise project at another school I've worked at, and they've been really quite useful. So here we go. Ready, steady, go. Here we go again. Let's try again. Ready? Ah! So you saw me juggling. Wasn't brilliant. Nearly made it to 30 seconds, but not quite, which was a bit sad. But, you know, I have a choice now. I can either give up and never try again, or I can keep having a go to see if I can get to that 30 second mark and perhaps even further. And you know what? Reading sometimes can feel a bit like that too. For some people, reading is a real challenge and it doesn't come easily. And the thing is, though, is that reading lies at the heart of success at school. And so if you can become a confident and fluent reader, your life at school becomes easier. And you also feel more success because so much of what we do at school is based on being able to read and understand. And then from learning from our reading, we can then write well and express ourselves really clearly. And so for what remains of this period of time, up until the end of term and then the summer holidays, I was going to talk through some books that you could read and talk to you about some reading challenges that are going to come up. And the books I've chosen to talk to you about today are all about people who didn't give up. The first one is The 11th Trade by Alyssa Hollingsworth. This is the story of a refugee boy from Afghanistan, and he has to part with something that's really, really precious, but he doesn't give up trying to get it back. And it's his story of Sammy. He's in the United States when he moves from his home country. And this is an award-winning book. As of yesterday, it won a UK National Award because it's a really great read. If you like animals, there's some books that I'm going to recommend today. This is by Michael Morpurgo. Some of you may have seen the film. Some of you may even have been lucky enough to see the show in London, War Horse. It's about Albert. It's set in the context of the First World War. And his beloved horse, Joey, absolutely loves this little horse that he raises from a foal. And then the army come and his dad sells Joey into the army to be used for an officer's horse. Albert never gives up, even though he's 15 when the war starts. He never gives up thinking that he's going to go overseas to France to find his horse and bring Joey home. I'm not going to tell you what happens. It's a really good read. Now, if you prefer non-fiction, real stories, so here is one. It's called Bob, No Ordinary Cat by James Bowen. James Bowen was homeless. He was on the streets and he was befriended by this cat. Now, sadly, you may have heard of this lately because this cat that made James, a homeless man, famous, actually died last week. Really sad. But this is James's story of how this cat helped him not give up. He was on the brink of thinking that life was not even worth living. And yet this cat came into his life and he lived because of the companionship of an animal. Another animal story, non-fiction, but a true life story, written by Dion Leonard. Now, Dion Leonard is an ultramarathon runner, and so he runs marathons back to back in the most inhospitable of places. And this is a story that took place when he was running a marathon through the Gobi Desert. Now, you can have a look on a globe and see where that is. And he was befriended by this little dog when he was on that marathon running experience. And this little dog ran by his side from about day 3 right through to the end of the event. And he couldn't bear to part with it. It was a stray. It found him in the desert. And he took it to a city in China and the dog went missing. And it's his story of never giving up trying to find this little dog that he called Gobi. Finally, two books about tales of survival in frozen landscapes. This one is good. If you don't like books that you have to read and it's great long reading, then this one is broken up into short tales of survival. And there's different ones and you can pick from wherever you like. It's Tales of Survivors, Extraordinary Tales from the Wild and Beyond. Really good book, comes highly recommended. And then for a more challenging read, there are two books. This is Mawson's Will, set in 1911, and he got stranded on an ice sheet and everybody thought he was dead. He was doing scientific experiments. Remarkable tale of survival, Mawson's Will, this book. And then finally, one book that I absolutely love. I don't have it because I've lent it to somebody. Touching the Void by Joe Simpson. You may have seen it. It's been made into a film. It was also a stage show in London shortly before lockdown. Incredible tale of survival. he and his climbing partner are climbing in Peru, and he falls and slips, and he's hanging over a precipice on the end of a rope. And it gets to the point where his partner, who's holding the rope and trying to survive himself and not to be pulled off a cliff face, decides that there's nothing he can do. He actually thinks his friend is dead on the end of the rope, and so he cuts the rope. Joe, in fact, was alive, and he lands in a crevice. And this book tells the tale of his survival, or not. Well, we know he lived to tell the tale because he's written a book. Incredible story there to read. We're also challenging you to read over the summer. We have a reading challenge for years 7 and 8. There are some suggested reads on it there. And we also have a reading challenge for year 9, which Miss March has put together. Brilliant job. And they are there. Now, all of these books are on sale at Chorley Wood Bookshop. You can get them there. They're hosting these reading lists for us if you fancy ordering from them. And a percentage of sales comes back to us to help buy books for our new library in the new school. And so look out for the reading challenges. They're going to be published before the end of term. Your English teachers will be sending them to you. We'll also send them out in an email. So look out for those. Different things that you can do. But don't give up with your reading journeys. It's so important to become fluent, confident readers. And we can learn so much from people who haven't given up too. Thanks.
Big thank you to Mrs. Broadis, and I'll move on to my own personal goals.
So although I haven't achieved my target yet, I thought I'd run you through a few top tips on how to ensure that you meet your targets. The first one is to plan appropriately. So make sure you plan what you're doing, you know when you're doing it, and you actually do it. So whether that's revision or training for something like this. The next one is to ensure you're dedicated. So when you're actually doing that revision or that practice, you are working extremely hard and you're putting in your maximum effort. The third piece of advice is to ensure that you always track your progress. So you see those small steps you've made, but you also accept the comebacks that come with it. So you don't always achieve those targets every single time you do it, but you appreciate when you do. The fourth one is to ensure you've got people around you to support you, whether that's your family, your friends, or just yourself, and making sure you know why you're doing it and make sure it's for the right reasons. And my fifth and final point is to ensure that you have the motivation and belief that you can achieve those goals, because at the end of the day, any goal can be achieved. So the final part of our assembly is over to Mr. Murphy to introduce and acknowledge all the results on the virtual sports day. Here's to next year for having our normal sports day.
Afternoon, everyone. I hope you're well and looking after yourself. This week, I'm going to be talking to you about the results of Virtual Sports Day. We had a fantastic uptake from you, which has been absolutely brilliant, and it was a pleasure to put it together for you. Before we announce the winners of each individual year group and the overall winner for Virtual Sports Day, I think it's important that we celebrate our champions. As part of the Virtual Sports Day, students will get a 12-point bonus if they are the ones who have excelled in the process of completing the tasks. In year 7, we have Mia in 7D and Charlie in 7M. In year 8, we have Nevaeh in 8G and Cam in 8G. And finally, in year 9, we have Megan for 9C and Zach for 9C. Fantastic job and well done to our champions. So what makes a good champion? Muhammad Ali hated every single minute of training, but he had that mindset to say, don't quit, suffer now and live the rest of your life as a champion. That for me showed true resilience and true perseverance, and that he was not going to stop until he reached his goals. I think there are lots of good examples in society that could have been shown to display perseverance and resilience. But I also think that you guys have shown true resilience and perseverance to be continuing the way that you are during this time. It's now time to announce the results of this year's Virtual Sports Day. We're going to start off with year 7s. In third place in year 7 was 7G with 369 points. In second place, we have 7D with 438 points. And in first place in year seven is 7C with 487 points. Well done, Cassio Bridge. Into year eight. In third place, we have 8M with 421 points. In second place, we have 8C with 532 points. And in first place, we have 8G with 590 points. Well done, Gonville. And finally, in year nine, in third place, we have 9S with 481 points. In second place, we have 9C with 609 points. And in first place, we're 9J with 685 points. Well done to Jaggers. It's now time to announce this year's overall Virtual Sports Day winner. We had lots of entries and it really showed your commitment to Croxley Dane School. So without further ado, this year's winner is Cassio Bridge. Well done, Cassio Bridge, fantastic result. Just on a final note, I'd like to say thank you for everyone who participated. You've done exceptionally well and I'm really, really proud of you guys. Hope you have a fantastic summer in a couple of weeks' time, and I look forward to seeing you all hopefully in September. Many thanks, cheers.
So once again, a huge thank you to all the staff that have got themselves in this week's assembly. As you can see, a lot of hard work and dedication has gone into just creating the videos for you to see what's been going on. I'm sure you've all had your own challenges that you've had to face throughout the last 14 weeks. And I'm sure that you'll still have some other challenges that you'll want to accomplish before we return in September. But for now, from all the staff and myself, have a safe and restful 6 weeks off, and I'll see you all in September.